यू डॉक्टर वाविकर. आई वुड लाइक टू नाउ इनवाइट डॉक्टर कुमार फॉर हिज टॉक ऑन प्रेसबाइलेसिस.
I'm surprised because Dr. Wavikar spent half of his time explaining the cornea. And I was informed this is not a debate, so this was more of an informative lecture. I'm going to tell you certain things that he said is completely wrong, so I don't want you to go back home with wrong information. Whether we can correct an unhappy presbyopic patient, answer is very well, quite easy, and they can be corrected. Because if the patient has had presbyopic multifocal corneal treatment, and if the patient is unhappy, we lift the cornea, do a corneal wavefront guided treatment of if any refractive error, and the patient becomes happy. So patient remaining unhappy is not possible, so it's very much reversible. That's point number one. Point number two, there is no computer vision, which I don't agree, because presbyopic corneal vision refraction works on the principle of two eyes being treated together, and that principle helps them in depth, and that's the reason why they can do reading, they can do computer, everything at the same time. So again, I refrain from saying that this is a debate. I'm here to give information on presbyopic correction at the corneal level. So what are our options at the corneal level? One is monovision in LASIK. Are patients unhappy? Answer is no. They are happy. If they are convinced, so you give them a trial of monovision contact lens wear, and if they are happy for a week, they understand what you are doing, do it. I've operated some of the film stars with monovision at the age of 50, okay, and they are extremely happy. It doesn't enter their head because of different IQ, but once they use it for some time, they are extremely happy. And believe me, at 50, I've done monovision, operated only one eye, and they're extremely happy. They say, no, no, it doesn't make sense because they can't understand what it is. But once they do it, they use it, they never come back for the other eye. Advantage of monovision, if they become unhappy, you can treat it and make them happy again. So this is all possible. But we have monovision with CK, as rightly mentioned by him or somebody said that CK is out. CK came with a bang, it went out with equal bang or no bang. Intracore, which is being talked about, and presbyopic LASIK and corneal inlays and onlays. So monovision, yes, we know that dominant eye, non-dominant eye, non-dominant eye works for near, distance dominant eye, you can treat only one eye and accordingly it works. If you convince the patient will be happy and it does work quite well. So monovision, of course, it was an off-label use in 2007 in July. US FDA gave approval for monovision on the Excimer laser platform also. And then comes to monovision and conduitive keratoplasty. This quite works, but this was more for hyperopia. CK was more for hyperopia. The disadvantage of CK was that it went off very soon because it was very, very, very temporary. Coming to intracore, a lot of talk is being done on the intracore now. Basically here, the treatment is done with the help of the femto, where there are multiple layers of ablation which takes place at the level of the cornea. This gives you good distance, good intermediate and depth. I have no experience with intracore, but there are two machines in India. You might already know, one is in Hyderabad, one is in Coimbatore, and they say that it's quite effective, fast, minimally invasive, shorter treatment time, and does give good amount of reading as well. And there are two corneal inlays and outlays, which actually is like a pinhole. So their contact lens is placed under the flap of the laser. After the flap is made, you actually put a contact lens inside. It gives pinhole vision and gives depth. So there are different types of corneal inlays which are there. One is the made by different companies from Switzerland as well as US. I have no personal experience, but this is there in the market as this time. Coming to the topic of pseudophakic presbyopia, I don't know why this half slide is going out. Any idea? Yeah. On my laptop, it's complete, no? Why? Got it. I will talk on something very, very different about pseudophakic presbyopic LASIK. So is this possible or not possible? Well, I have the MRIs and with that I feel nothing is impossible. The advantage is you need a system which actually not only tracks. So if you have a system which tracks only the pupil, you're actually doing only X and Y. So can you have a decenter treatment on an Excimer laser which tracks only pupil? The answer is yes. Because it's only tracking the pupil which is at a different plane. If the patient looks slightly down, your treatment on the cornea will be decentered, and this is quite possible. So we need a system which tracks limbus, which tracks pupil, which looks after cyclo, which looks after eye roll. And if that's possible, then your tracking is somewhat good and your chances of having a decentered treatment are not there. If you want to do multifocality on the cornea, you have to have a brilliant tracking system, and then only you can apply that knowledge. Here we have the cyclotorsion monitoring. Like we know in the VZEX, you take an imprint of the iris, the patient lies down, you superimpose the imprint of the iris, and then the treatment takes over, and that is static cyclotorsion monitoring. We have the dynamic cyclotorsion monitoring also, like the static. So once the patient lies down, the iris imprint is superimposed, which are the crepes of the iris, and then the dynamic takes over, and that's the reason why it's continuous cyclotorsion monitoring. Well, in life, all searches do not give results. But we're trying to get there, and a lot of discussions will happen in presbyopia, because I feel next 2, 3, 4 years will be presby discussion, because everyone wants good results in presby, whether you treat it at the level of the lens or you treat it at the level of the cornea. Coming to Presby Max, it is a very simple procedure. It's a software invented by Professor Alio from Alicante. It is nothing different. So it's just a software. You do LASIK like a normal thing. The biggest advantage of Presby Max is you can treat the distance refractive error at the same time. So if the patient is myopic, hyperopic, or astigmatic, you treat and you treat the addition that the patient has got. So this is how actually we are creating three parts of zone. The center one is for reading, then it's for intermediate distance, and then for distance. So of course, it is pupil dependent, and there are certain principles which we cannot jump. Coming to, it's basically a biaspheric treatment. As I mentioned, it's a binocular treatment. So you cannot do a Presby Max treatment only in one eye, and it's not advisable. You need to treat both eyes at the same time. It's binocular and gives good, comfortable distance for all ranges. The idea of you doing this study was, we do routine patients of presbyopia anyway. But now the question is, can we apply the same knowledge to pseudophakic patients? So we went ahead and did the LASIK for pseudophakic patients, 15 patients, 30 eyes, this is the ratio. We had single piece lenses, foldables, including Alcon IQ, pachymetry of so-and-so, and all the patients underwent aspheric presbyopic treatment. So for the purpose of the study, we did not do corneal wavefront guided or ocular wavefront guided, but we did a simple aspheric treatment for all of them. Myopes, this is the ratio, hyperopes 10, plano, there was 3 eyes which were plano for distance. This is the mean spherical equivalent. Coming to the best corrected visual acuity, all of them were 6x6 for distance. And for near, they were N6 with the relative add. The lowest add was +2, the highest add was +3, knowing obviously that each and every eye was pseudophakic. All patients had wavefront analysis, topography. We looked at the pupil size. We looked at the offset in hyperopia. And all patients underwent refractive error corrections for distance and near at the same time. I use a Cariazo pendulum microkeratome, and we have the online pachymetry on the MRS Examiner laser. I have a 1 month and a 6 month follow-up. This is the mean spherical equivalent. If you look at this part, and then we look at the post-op after 6 months, there's not that bigger change. But I'll tell you the actual results. The results comes to that 73%. Let me go to the bar chart here. That 100% were 6x6 with glasses for distance, okay? It became 73% 6x9 for distance. It means what? That there is a compromise for distance best corrected visual acuity, which the patient is informed, and then the patient agrees to that. Now let's look at, this is distance, okay? Now let's look at near, for which the whole idea of doing it, they're 100% for near, that is N6 with the refractive error, and after surgery, they're 100%, 97%, for N6 for near. That means, you'll be surprised, I operated one of my good friends, was a hyperope, which anyway they do very, very well. But in 2 hours after surgery, they can read the small prescription which comes with the bottles, their eye bottles. And I did live surgery in Chandigarh, which was a presbyopic LASIK, and the same result we got in 1, 1.5 hours, the patient can read that finer print after surgery. So yes, there is a compromise for distance, but the purpose of doing the surgery is to get brilliant quality near vision, which is quite achievable with this. Let's look at a little bit of a topo picture. You can see a little bit of steepening in this area. So if I had done a corneal wavefront guided treatment and presbyopic LASIK, I could have taken care of this steepening if I wanted to. But we did an aspheric treatment, and this is what you get. You get a nice little steepening right in the center. That is this. If this steepening does not happen, there was a study done by Professor Holland in Germany. They also did about 15 or 18 patients, and 2 patients did not have this steepening right in the center. If that does not happen, this steepening is not there, the patient will not be able to read, mind you. So we are creating that little bit of steepening in the center. Let's look at the other eye. This is the left eye. Again, a little bit of steepening on the top. And we got brilliant steepening right in the center. That is this. And that's the reason why the patient is able to read very, very well. So in summary, 1 month and 6 months, does presbyopic LASIK work for pseudophakic patients? Yes, 90% for uncorrected visual acuity and best corrected 6x6 part. No eye showed worsening more than 6x9. One out of three eyes actually worsened because they were 6x6, went to 6x6 part. And 97% of the patients were best corrected for N6 for near and best. So statistically, there was no difference found between 1 month and 6 months. I'm just showing you a little video. It works? Oh, okay. As far as pseudophakic presbyopic LASIK is concerned, there's nothing really different. It's just normal LASIK that is done, but you will just see the reflection. This is the Cariazzo pendula. It's one of the most easy microkeratomes to use. There is only two rings. You don't need to lock anything or unlock anything. It's called the drop-and-go technique. We have the 90 micron head, the 110 and the 130. Put in the microkeratome once you got your suction and then make your flap. You can see the reflection of the light coming off from the surface of the IOL. Once you got your hold, just go ahead and put the pendular system. We have 110, 130. The 130 does 110. This is what one thing I do. I put one drop of methyl cellulose, and on that I put the water, and that prevents the friction because in elderly patients, the basement membrane is slightly weak, and there's a tendency that when your microkeratome head goes onto the corneal surface, there might actually remove the epithelium. So that's one care that I take additional as far as elderly patients go. Once the flap is done, there's nothing different. You'll just see that the ablation goes on like normal and both eyes are treated at the same time. In the Cariazzo, we need to put a contact lens post-op. We keep it in for 24 hours. The contact lens is dipped in moxigram for 20 minutes. There is a theory which says that if the contact lens is kept in antibiotic for 20 minutes, it's a good depot for 24 hours. This was invented by Professor Theo Seiler, and I learned that trick from there, and I use it for all my patients, and it works quite well. So this is just like normal LASIK. There is nothing else, and treatment goes on. Many times in life, we don't know what is going to hurt more. Look at the dog, okay? What's going to hurt more? Is it the fall or the bush? We don't know, but in life, we learn only with experience. This is a certificate we received from Schwind because we were the first in the world to do pseudophakic presbyopic correction. Professor Alio, who's invented the formula itself, had done normal presbyopic patients and never attempted the same on pseudophakic patients, which we applied the same knowledge. I thank you all for your attention.
Just a quick comment. Yeah. We also started using the SupraCore. We not used on the presbyopic. I think congratulate you on trying to do it on these sort of people is much more difficult. In the small limited series of 10 patients, we learned certain few things which I thought I will share with you.
Rohit, you start from basics. Like some of us don't know what SupraCore.
Okay, SupraCore is nothing but same presbyopic LASIK from the Technolas platform. It's a different name. Probably works on the same principle. Some of them are not happy. And it used to happen that at least two or three of them are very unhappy. And they remained unhappy after 3-4 months. And it was like preferential. They said left eye not happy, right eye not happy, right eye now. So what we started doing is everything, all the parameters were same. Then we started looking at their optics. All of them had the eyes which were unhappy had early signs of aging lens changes. In fact, one of the most prominent change was trefoil again and a spherical aberration. And it's 100% a pattern. Now, if I have to evaluate a patient, I would first, more than the topography, I look at their lens. Because the issue is, on an undilated pupil, exactly where you are trying to create a multifocality, and if that same area has got irregular, unwanted aberrations, then you are creating more havoc to the patient. So, and the second thing which I learned from this is these patients have more dry eye than, because already they are 50, 45, 50. So tear film plays a more important role. And because there is multifocality, the tear film is. This is the two things which I thought I'll share it with everybody.
Dr. Kumar, I definitely agree with everything you said. In my own practice also, I am doing a lot of advanced monovision. The point is that I was just trying to highlight, like, you know, from IL point, IL, what are the plus points? And I have been discussing this technique with Dr. Sujal, and I know it, how well it works. What Dr. Rohit elaborated is again the same thing, that we have to choose the patient and the surgery very carefully. Both work at times and both fail at times. Thank you.
Problems like multifocal, like glare and night vision problems.
If Rohit gives me a job in his Narayan Netralaya, then I would like to work with him because he has all the bloody equipment to analyze everything. But the funny part is they do not complain like multifocal IOLs. Now, I have a logical explanation to this. I don't have a scientific explanation. The logical explanation is we are far from the nodal point. And that's the reason why they do not complain. That one pseudophakic was Dr. Manish Sharma's patient, which I operated. And he came to me with a mobile phone or a tablet and saying that I can't read my tablet. And it was a bloody first generation tablet. And I looked at it and I said, which one is this? Because I have some knowledge in that. I said, you need to chuck this and buy a new generation tablet where your brightness control and you'll be fine. So that old generation tablets anyway did not have any contrast or brightness on the screen or anything like that. So I feel that because you're far from the nodal point, their complaint of night glare, halos, loss of contrast is really not there. And another thing is that if they can read, they're so excited anyway, they forget all the other side effects. That's my analysis, I'm not too sure, but the scientific part is Rohit and I'm the other side.